Shakti is, it's not something new. It's been existing for a worship of mother has been existing since Indus Valley civilization. We have found seals where you can see the divine mother between the two trees. It looks like, you know, the tree and the a female form, and a male with a bull is bowing down to her. And then there are seven female goddesses right at the bottom. So this is from Indus Valley civilization. So worship of the female goddess has been since ancient time in every culture, in every religion, in every place, it's been there. And possibly this is SaptMatrika, and that is the divine power, Shakti, Lalita Tripura Sundari, Parvati, whatever you want to call it. And that's Pashupati or Shiva bowing down to her because she is the one who has, maybe some there are many, many stories, and asking for forgiveness and asking for food because she is the universe. So Shri Matre Namah to everyone. So Shri is the auspiciousness. Matre is the mother in all of us. And I'm bowing down to the mother, auspicious mother in all of us. Shri Matre Namah. So today's topic, like Nilima said, has changed over time for me many, many times. And really the journey I came in January, it was supposed to be a holiday, and it turned out to be the downpour of the Matrikas. The moment I got this subject, it has changed my life, because I was more, you know, the divine loving Shakti, the presence of a heart and love and joy and happiness, and then the Kali showed up in me. The Matrika, which is also in me, but wasn't so prevalent. So I had to learn many things that I didn't know about myself. I'm really grateful for this topic that Nilima gave me. So I'm going to invoke here my gurus, and I'm going to start from that. I'm Hrim Shrim, I'm Kleem Sauh. Hamsa Shiva Soham Hasaka Frame Hasaksha Malvariyum Hasom Sahaksha Malvariim Saho Sarupa Nirupa Hetave Sagurve Shri Annapurnamba Sahita Shri Amritanandanatha Shri Guru Shri Padukam Pujayami Tarpayami Namaha. I'm Hrim Shrim, I'm Kleem Soh, Hamsa Shiva Soham, Hasaka Frem, Hasaksha Malvariyom Hasom, Sahaksha Malvariyim Sahom, Sarupa Nirupa Hetave Sagurve, Shri Annapurnamba Sahita, Shri Amritanandanatha, Shri Guru, Shri Padukam, Pujayami, Tarpayami, Namaha. Shuklam Paradharam Vishnum, Shashivarnam Chaturbhujam Prasannavadanam Dhyaye Sarva Vigno Pashantaye Gananam Tva Ganapati Gum Havamahe Kavim Kavinam Upamashrivastramam Jeshtirajam Brahmanam Brahmanasvatanan Survan Nutvidihi Shirisadhanam Shri Mahaganadipataye Namaha. Om Shreem Hreem Kleem Glom Gam Ganapataye Varavarada Sarvajanam Me Vashamane Swaha. Saraswati Namastubhyam Varade Kamarupini Vidyarandham Karishyami Siddhir Bhavatu Me Sada. I'm Vakvadini Swaha. I'm Vakvadini Swaha. I'm Vakvadini Swaha. So, we have been talking a lot about the mother. And so, What is Shakti? Can anybody tell me what is Shakti? We've been talking about Shakti all the time. I want to know more. What is Shakti for you? How is Shakti showing up for you? What is Shakti?
It's pure consciousness.
Pure consciousness. Yeah, what else? Energy. What else? Anybody else? Huh? Divine force. Tell me more. There's unlimited ways to say, right? Shakti. Movement. Power. Mother. Yeah, she's that force that can bring about change. She's the power behind manifestation, behind creation, behind sustenance, behind everything. And how do we express this Shakti? You know, we are, Shakti is this power to change ourselves from within. And, you know, we are basically, today, in today's world, Shakti is needed because we've become so egotistic, so greedy, so self about I, me, mine. And we have forgotten that Shakti is not just that. Shakti is, has a very bigger vision, very bigger point of view than us, just a tiny me and mine. So that Shakti that can bring about the whole universal consciousness into being is, you know, the divine Shakti. And we are her representation here, especially women. Women are the tiny representation of the divine mother, cosmos. And go down to the next slide. In Sri Vidya, I come from the Sri Vidya Tantra. That's my background for this talk. I'm talking about the Sapta Matrika through the point of view of the divine Shakti. And this is Lalita Devi. Now you see her iconography here. She's sitting on the plank, which is Sadashiva. Her right is Maha Lakshmi. Her left is Maha Saraswati. And there are four gods at the bottom as the feet of the plank, of the chair, throne that she's sitting on. Brahma, Vishnu, Rudra, and Ishvara. And below is the Ganesha and Kartikeya and Sri Yantra at the bottom. So this is a representation of the whole of cosmos in this image. Now, Lalita Tripura Sundari is the one who's sitting with the in union with Shiva. So, but Shiva is called Shava basically because he is inert. He until the Shakti makes him, you know, manifest, he is not able to manifest. She is the manifestation. She is the creation. She is the power behind him. So that's what is the Shakti. Shakti is it is how everything comes into being. So everything that exists here is Shakti. But the consciousness that is beyond is Shiva. Like he is the blank canvas on which the presentation is happening. You see that board, the black board behind is Shiva. But the Shakti is the colors, the sound, the whatever is happening in our life. Our lives are Shakti. Our life is this animation of drama, the play that's going on. That's all the play of Shakti. Whereas Shiva is just watching. It's this awareness, it's this consciousness that is observing, constantly observing. They're together. They're always together. The observation and creation, they are together. And that's called the union of Shiva and Shakti. But through the perspective of I'm a Shakta, Shakta, where the Shakti is the highest force. Without her, nothing would exist. So we worship the Shakti. But so, you know, if you ask the Shaivites, they will say Shiva is the highest force and Vishnu is the highest force. But for me, Shakti, because she is the creation itself. She is the one who created everything. So she is the highest. And that's why we worship the Shakti in Shakta tradition. And Sri Vidya is the Shakta tradition. So Shakti is... it's not something new. It's been existing for a worship of mother has been existing since Indus Valley civilization. We have found seals where you can see the divine mother between the two trees. It looks like, you know, the tree and the a female form and a male with a bull is bowing down to her. And then there are seven female goddesses right at the bottom. So this is from Indus Valley civilization. So worship of the female goddess has been since ancient time in every culture, in every religion, in every place, it's been there. And possibly this is Saptamatrika, and that is the divine power, Shakti, Lalita Tripura Sundari, Parvati, whatever you want to call it. And that's Pashupati or Shiva bowing down to her because she is the one who has, maybe some, there are many, many stories, and asking for forgiveness and asking for food because she is the universe. She is the world that is expressed here. So Divine Mother, at one level, it is the in Devi Mahatmya chronicle between the Devi and the Asura. At another level, it deals with our inner battle between the divine and the demonic forces within us. So it's a constant representation of the divine and the demonic forces. That is the battle within us that's been portrayed in the as a, you know, the battle of the Devas and Asuras. And there are many myths and origins in Purana about Shakti. And they're narrated in Mahabharata, Devi Mahatmya, and Varaha Purana. There are many Puranas that have a story of Shakti being described as a battleground representing, you know, our human consciousness that is arising to our higher consciousness. This is from the Narayani Stuti, where they're showing the battle. And in the Narayani Stuti, in Devi Mahatmya, in the 11th chapter, there's a great intense devotion and a blessed sense of fulfillment. There is a chant to Devi in the Devi Mahatmya. So they're from verse 13 to 21 in Narayani Stuti are dedicated to Matrikas. Basically, these Matrikas, so there's this one big force, the divine consciousness, that is creative force. And then there are tiny little mothers who help her win the battle within us. So those are the Matrikas. There are smaller mothers that come in to help the bigger mother to fight the battle. So they are in the Narayana Stuti described as Brahmani, Maheshwari, Kaumari, Vaishnavi, Varahi, Narasimhi, Indrani, Shivaduti, Chamunda, and Kali. But through the perspective of Sri Vidya and Sri Yantra, which I'm going to be talking about, there are basically eight. Seven are the main, and the eighth one is the Mahalakshmi. So they are basically Brahmani, Maheshwari, Kaumari, Vaishnavi, Varahi, Mahendri, which is Indrani, Chamunda, and Mahalakshmi. So we have those seven and eight in the Devi Mahatmya. Also, it is in Skanda Purana. There is a story about Matrikas. Matrikas have been mentioned in many places. In Skanda Purana, the story about how Skanda was, the adopted mothers were seven Matrikas. I don't know if there was a talk about it. So he was brought by, because Shiva and Shakti, the Tarkasura had this thing where he got a boon that he only wanted to be killed by the son of Shiva. And Shiva did not want to have children because he was, you know, meditation and observation and silence and stillness, but he didn't want to come as manifestation. So, but when Tarkasura became a demon, like he was creating a havoc in the universe, so the Shiva and Shakti had to give birth to a child, but the Shiva seed is very hard to keep. So they meditated and they got through their meditation, Shiva and Shakti's meditation, the energy that was invoked in creation of Kartikeya was too hot to carry by the Parvati. So the Agni Devata comes, the fire god, and carries that heat, the ball of energy, into the Ganges and drops it in the Ganges. And the Saptamatrikas come and look after the Kartikeya. So they are there. That's another story. There are many, many stories about Saptamatrikas. So, but basically, they are in Sri Vidya. They are considered very the mothers that are loving as well as fierce. They can nourish you as well as give you a hit if you need to. So they represent everything, but they are basically for your good. They want your at the end of everything. They are there to support you. So I will show, this is Sri Yantra, Sri Chakra, that we worship. And I will get into deeper meaning of this, how Saptamatrika, where they are. Because as we worship the Sri Yantra, we worship through him called Khadagamala. Khadga itself means sword. And mala, the sword of the mala of swords. That's what it means. So the meaning of Khadagamala is that cutting the swords that are cutting your head off. So it's an invocation of basically cutting your head off, which means your ego, your pride, your greed, your shame. When you're praying to Sri Yantra, people think it's, you know, you put it to bring money and wealth and fortune and all of that. But it's completely the opposite. It actually brings you to the divine, the highest plane there exists. And to go there, you have to get rid of your ego and pride and all of that. That's when you can rise higher and higher and higher and meet the divine. So that's what the Sri Yantra represents. And each triangle and each petal and each, everywhere there is a yogini and chakreshwari, which you pray to, and it gives you the powers and the energy of that that triangle that it represents. That energies are invoked into you. So it is a very, very deep study. It's a tantric study and vidya, which just takes actually many, many years. But, coming from Devipuram, my guru, Guruji Amritananda, he wanted everyone to learn this. And he wanted to have it simplified and be done by anybody and everybody. So that was his goal. So he made it simple procedure that anybody and everybody could practice anywhere in their life. So that was the beauty of Sri Yantra. And the Saptamatrikas are in Sri Yantra, but to go there, we have to understand the whole Sri Yantra. So I'm going to take you through the Sri Yantra briefly, and then we understand where the Saptamatrikas and why their role is what it is. So Sri Yantra has 9 avarnas, and 9 layers. Avarnas means layers, basically. And you can go from the bindu to the right at the square, or a square represents our lives here right now, or from the square to the bindu. So square to the bindu is how the Khadagamalas are worshipped, where you are here in the square, which represents, earth plane, and then you keep going layer by layer, higher and higher and higher, and meet the Shiva and Shakti right at the bindu. So that's what Sri Yantra represents. And, it just comes through a lot of practice, but more so, I think, devotion, surrender, samarpan. You know, when you start to samarpan and just let yourself be, these yoginis and chakreshwaris start to show you. They start to show, what is stopping you, what is your problem, and why are you getting stuck, and where you're getting stuck, and you start progress. They hold your hand. And they show you how to cross over and move forward. That is the beauty of Sri Chakra. It literally, there's no hidden, everything will appear to you. Where you are, you will know exactly where you are. Because it's like a crossing an ocean, but step by step, you keep going, you keep taking, steps, and you'll keep knowing where you are and how you have to go forward. So there is you get initiated, and after the initiation you start. I actually was from my childhood, like Nilima was saying, I was a Buddhist. At age 19, I got introduced to Vipassana, and I did Vipassana all my life. But I don't know how it happened, because my tradition is Shakta tradition. My mother is a very big Shakti herself, so it was in the family, which I was denying it, I guess. So what, I don't know how it happened, then mantra came to me, and I was searching and I was looking, what is this mantra, how to go find it, where to go find it. I found Devipuram, and I found the Guruji, and I got the initiation. And as soon as I had the initiation, it was like a downpour of knowledge flooding in. I could not stop it. I want 24/7, I was searching how to learn, how to go, where to go, what to do. It just happens. Like, this is, each one will be different, but for me, it was spiritual journey. I wanted my spiritual growth. That was my deepest, whatever is your deepest desire, your deepest longing, your deepest, the Shakti in you will speak, and it will start to manifest that for you. For me, it was learning about Sri Vidya. and going deeper into that and learning that and going as much as far as I can go, you know. So, and eventually uniting with Shiva and Shakti, that was my goal, and I have been learning forever, you know. So that's, each one is different, but it's a magical journey. It's absolutely a magical journey. And so the Bindu, now Bindu is this. This is all drawings done by Guruji Amritananda, and it represents our bodies. Actually, the whole Sri Yantra is our body. And it shows where, you know, the Bindu is where sun and the moon and the whole Ida and Pingla and Sushumna, the body, a union of Shiva and Shakti is all there. So, you know, it is a point. It's called Navam Avarna, where it's a dimensionless point where Shiva and Shakti are one. So basically, before the universe was created, there was nothing, absolutely nothing. And there was like, it is said that Shiva, which is nothing, looked into a mirror and saw his reflection. That reflection is Shakti. That is the creation, that is the spandana that happened. He looked at it and wow, and that Shakti was like creative force. That I am going to, that was his wish to create the universe is his Shakti. His power to create the universe is his Shakti. That is what it represents. And the Bindu is like the Spuratta, the spread of cosmic flow. The beginning of the universe starts, you know, from the Bindu, and it goes down to the triangle. And this triangle represents, so as soon as there's this vibration, the Shakti he's looked into the mirror and the Shakti has appeared and she wants to create. Now she wants to create because women are the creator. That's why they're called Shaktis, because Shakti is object and process of observation. That's what the main thing about the triads is, the subject, object, and process of observation. That's what it, if you are there, I am here, and I'm looking at you, there's a subject and object. And the relationship between the two is a triad between us. So that's when the creation happens with that, right? So that's Devi's Agnya Chakra, basically. And it's the eighth avarna. Ninth avarna was the Bindu, and the eighth avarna is the triangle. So there is representing all three, like sattva, rajas, tamas, and subject, object, or seer, seeing, and process of seeing, basically. And then this is like, you know, we have given a form, we have given a shape to the Divine Mother. There is really no shape, right? She is everything, everywhere, all the time. So, but we have made her form to represent how we can understand it better. That's all it is. So her ayudhas, like which are the what she holds in her hand, is, you know, she holds a sugarcane bow, which represents our mind, because our mind is like, you know, a sweet. She controls that. And then there is this dhanusha and bana. Banas represent our five senses, and dhanusha is our, controlling the five senses. And pasha and ankusha is how she keeps you attracted to her, but still let you work. So it's always like when I said surrender, it is literally, you know, you are letting her play happen. You're not the instrument. You are her instrument now. It's not your will, or it's her will, her divine will that is happening through you. That's her pasha and ankusha. She keeps you in control. So, and then and there are the Nitya Devi. It's very complicated. It's all around that as well. Triads. So then happens the eight, after the triads, there's eight triangles. And this eight triangles is actually, this vibration has started happening. The universe is created now from the Bindu to triangle, subject, object, and process of seeing, Shiva, Shakti, and their observation of each other has created vibration. And now this vibration is coming as sound. They're sound vibrations. So this represents the sound vibration of all our aksharmalas, where the world is now beginning to be created. So, all our aksharmalas are in each one, each chakreshwari and yogini is symbolizing the aksharmala, basically. Ka, kha, ga, ga, na, ta, ta, da, na, pa, 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 ma. Each one is representation of those sounds. So the world is being created in sound form, sound vibration. and time, space, and, you know, causality, all of that has beginning to, still the universe is being created. We are not even present in this. Up till now, it's only happening in the cosmic level. And then comes the 10 triangles. The 10 triangles, first, they are, the Randa Shakti wants to express herself as many, right? We saw that. She wants to express herself as many. She is now, she is the creative force, the womb of the mother who wants to have many children. Each one of us, you know, is her creation. So this is, but that comes later. She is actually first going to create the universe itself. So now she started to create the universe. So this represents, you know, sixth avarna is the five element and its five properties. So five elements are what? Earth, water, fire, air, space, right? And its five properties are sound, touch, taste, smell, sight. So those are the five properties that these matrikas represent here, yoginis represent here. So we haven't come to the matrikas yet, but it's still the cosmos is being created. And once the cosmos is created, the next triangle is also 10 triangles. Okay, so here I'm just showing you the ether, air, fire, water, earth, and its sound, touch, vision, taste, smell. Now the next triangle, 10 triangles, also now it's becoming closer to us. Now up till it was the universe. Now she wants to create us. So she has to, you know, the five senses are given. Five senses of ear, skin, eyes, tongue, nose, all of that has been given to create human beings. And that then how these are the actions of ear is the speech. We are given the speech. And skin is we can feel the touch and giving and receiving. It's through the skin. Eyes are, you know, through the walking is our action. And tongue is connected to our procreation. And nose is excretion. So basically our bodies are being formed here. So bodies of the human is being formed in this 10 triangles that are shown here. And each one has a, you know, mudra, each one has this. There's a very complicated way to go through this. But I'm just explaining the basic so we can reach the matrikas. And so here now we are becoming now. And then comes this here, because I'm an Ayurvedic practitioner, so I look at everything. It represents many, many stuff. But here, there are 72,000 nadis, and it's all at the etheric, you know, it doesn't show in our body, 72,000 nadis, but they are in our subtle body. So, and the channels that exist in us, and chakras, and all of that. So these are representation of the 14 main nadis. And those 14 main nadis, the three are the main, which are Ida, Pingala, and Sushumna. You might all know, if you are yoga, you've done yoga, you will know Ida, Pina, Shukam, Sushumna. Those are the three main. And then there are others, which are Ida, Pingala, Alambusa, which supplies energy to the organs of elimination. So it goes from the nabhi to the kidney and anus and base of spine. So the lower chakras, you know, alambusized. And Kuhu supplies energy to the genitals. So it's from Manipura, navel, to Swadhisthana chakra. And Vishvodhara, energy to the digestive system, which is from Muladhara to Manipura, so down to up. And Anahata, so comes to the heart. So Hasti Jiva, energy to the left limb, Muladhara to Manipura. So these are the descriptions of where these all of these nadis are. So it's very complicated, but as you chant it, you're invoking these. You're actually purifying. Up till now, all of this, you're just invoking all of this into you. As you're understanding also, it's getting invoked into you. You know, so yeah, these are energies of the limbs and energy of the circulatory system, energy of your throat and mouth. You know, Gandhari is for your eyes. You know, if you've heard of Gandhari, who used to put in Mahabharata, eyes are, so it's connected to eyes. You know, Pusha, most of these are also representation in other texts. These names will come up as something else also. Pusha is your left eye and right eye, Sushumna and Prana and Kumbha. So these are our representation. And now, you know, our subtle bodies are formed. All of this up till now, our subtle bodies are formed. And then we are going to these petals. petals are, eight-petal lotus gives us, the gifts to rise above, because all of the triangles are still in consciousness, like it's in the subtle body and a universal body. And to reach there, we have to go through the eight-petal lotus. And so the yoginis gives us the gift, our connection, so that we can easily go and connect to our subtle body. And then we are going to the 16 petals, which represents how in this world we should function. So these are all Chakreshwari, all of them each represents a yogini and a Chakreshwari. So each one is a power that you imbibe, you get. Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, everything they help you overcome. And then comes the Bhupura. So Bhupura is where Matrikas are residing. So finally I come to this. From the creation, we have come all the way down to the earth plane. And earth plane is where we have all our problems, right? All our issues are because we are in the living here, experiencing everything. So everything comes, we experience it. Whatever it is in our mind, in our body, we experience it. So these yoginis help us overcome that. So Matrikas are, the first ones are Siddhis. The first line, Bhupura, is these four lines. Right here, if you see the lines, there are three lines in the square. The first line is all your gift, all your Siddhis. So the Siddhi to become small, which means humble. Siddhi to become big, which means, you can reach your highest, whatever you want. So you get a lot of gift Siddhis in the first line. The second line is the Matrikas. You see Brahmani, Maheshwari, Kaumari, Vaishnavi, then Varahi is at the corner, Mahendri is at that corner, Chamunda is that corner, and Maha Lakshmi. So they are actually eight Matrikas. Maha Lakshmi is the overarching, who is just loving, kind, and generosity. But the other seven are the ones who actually, how can you go up? How can you go up if you're holding on to all your greed and lust and passion? And you need to have your clear system to rise up higher to higher levels. So they help you to clarify. These are the Ugra Devatas who help clear and cleanse us, basically. And that's what is in the second. And how to communicate with them is in the third line. So the third line is actually Mudra Shaktis. So Mudra Shaktis is, if you see on top, there is Dram, Dream, Kleem, Bloom, Saha. So there is subtle communication that you start to have with these Matrikas. And this communication percolates. It's like you just do the mudra. How can it solve your problems? By just doing mudra to Brahmani, Dram, like that. But, I used to wonder, how does it help? How a mudra can help communicate? But it's like, you're having you call someone, hey, you come here. I want to talk to you, right? Like your eyes and gesture is there. That's what is mudra. You're literally having a communication with them. You're opening them up. Basically, you're opening your will to their will so that you can have interaction with them. So these gifts start to come as you do the Khadagamala chant. So this all shows up in the Khadagamala chant, in as you chant. So this is actually the Matrikas in Devipuram. So you see, the Guruji Amritananda, he used to have visions of all the gods. The whole temple is actually, each isn't in shape of Sri Yantra, and each triangle has a statue of the goddess, which represents that Shakti, that power. And he had the vision of these Matrikas and these yoginis and these Chakreshwari, everything. He had a vision and he portrayed that vision into these statues. So it's very, very powerful. So there are Brahmani, Maheshwari, Kaumari, Vaishnavi, Varahi, Mahendri, Chamunde, and then Mahalakshmi Laya. So this is Devipuram, if you look. It's in the shape of Sri Yantra. And each triangle will have a goddess sitting there, which represents the whole, representation of her. And there's everyday pujas and sadhanas happening there. So it's a very, very powerful temple. And then Brahmani. So what are these Matrikas? Now I come to the Matrikas. Brahmani is basically kama, desire, lust. I'm going to go more in details. Maheshwari represents krodha, anger. Kaumari is lobha or greed, you know. Moha is Vaishnavi, delusion, Vaishnavi. Varahi is arrogance. Mahendri is false finding or jealousy or envy. Now, Chamunda is this righteousness or unrighteousness, basically, actually. And Mahalakshmi is the overarching complete righteousness. So this is what they represent. So these are not some easy, they are Ugra Devatas. They are very ferocious ones who actually clear out all of this from you. So before you can go rise up, you have to get rid of all of this. So that's what it is. So Brahmani. So if you look at Brahmani, she is, the mantra is, let me just chant the mantra. Hamsa yukta vimanaste Brahmani rupadharini kosambhari ke devi narayani namastute. So she is the first one who actually is in the battle of, the Devi Mahatmyam. There was a battle. And in the battle, the Devi is fighting with the Asuras. And at one point, then, there's Mahishasura and Raktabija. Every blood that drops, multifolds are being created. So the battle is getting ferocious. Like every drop of blood on the ground, same clones are being created. Right? So how to stop them? So she creates these smaller goddesses, who is her army. So they come out of her third eye and they help her in the battle. So those are the Matrikas, actually. So Brahmani is the first one. She is the Brahmas and the Brahma, Vishnu, Rudra, and all of these gods that we saw as the foot and plank and all of that. They gave their shaktis, their feminine power, their energy to these goddesses. So Brahmani represents the Brahma's shakti, basically. So Brahma, if you know Brahma, he's the creator. So his shakti is creation. So she's got his ayudhas, his weapons, all his weapons she's carrying. His, swan was his vahana, is also her vahana. So, and she has a book in her hand, and she has a mala, bead malas in her other hand, and she has a kamandala, water, that she's carrying. And so these are her, same as Brahmas. So this is just depiction, and basically, what is creation? Like, it's the knowledge. It's the jnana, buddhi. Saraswati is also represented. Gayatri is also a representation of that, right? So Brahmani represents the knowledge. So if you are Brahmani, she has yellow complexion and four hands. She has four arms holding a different attributes of Brahma, such as rosary, kamandalu, trident, and manuscript in her two hands, and varada and mudra. So she is seated on a lotus, and a swan and or a goose as her mount. So Brahmani is gold in color, and she has three faces. So Brahma resides, there is a... So knowledge, jnana, when you think about knowledge, jnana, what comes to you? Where do you get jnana from? Where do you get knowledge from? Right, but the first, your mother was your first guru, first teacher who taught you. So that's also Brahmani. Your children, anybody who gives you any knowledge is actually representation of Brahmani. Think about what might be that you have, and even sometimes you learn from other people, your enemies teach you something. They are also representation. We have to see these in our life. What is it that in our life we are... and once we start invoking them, we start seeing them everywhere. Everything that happens to you in your life is representation, basically, because once these matrikas are awake, they are teaching you in every way. So you have to start seeing them, like she will start showing you, look, it is, you think you know everything. Here, your child is teaching you. Has it happened to you? All the time, right? Your children are your teachers. So that's what your mind opens up to, everything that, who is your teacher? That's Brahmani. And Guru, of course, the lineage that it comes in, that comes. Brahmani Shakti is that brings you the knowledge, the Guru, the lineage, and and the Vimana, Hamsa is the invocation of the energy that's coming in to our hearts, and Sa is back connecting to the universe. So that's the breath coming in and breath going out. As you breathe in, it's Hum. As you breathe out, it's the sound of the breath coming in is Ha. And the sound of the breath going out is Sa. So if you try for a minute, just see how you feel. So Ha, breathe in. Ha. And breathe out. Sa. So the sound that comes in is ha, and the sound that goes out is sa. Ha. Sa. So connecting to Brahmani is through this mantra, Hamsa. You can connect with her if you want the knowledge, you know, the Guru, the lineage coming into you. Just chant the mantra Hamsa and focus on your breath. Hum. Sa. Hum. Sa. Sa. So, why is she connected to karma? So, can you see what karma is? So Brahmani is this, pleasure. Pleasure, experience of an object with five senses that you like a lot. When you like something, you really want it more and more and more and more. That's called karma, when you just can't get enough of it. When you keep asking for the same experiences, same knowledge, when you're even to the extent, even at the spiritual level, at a spiritual level too, we are greedy. We are in this, I want more, I want to study more, I want to know more, I just want to go everywhere and learn everything. We just don't want to be focused and just know one thing. We just want to know everything, you know. So that's like kind of over representation of, it's actually a representation of, if you've done the Devi Mahatmyam chant, it's Madhu and Ketaba. Those are two demons that are right in the beginning of the Devi Mahatmyam. Madhu is the sweetness. That sweetness that you want. You want that sugar. You want that craving of, you want somebody who praises you a lot. You want somebody who's constantly telling you how great you are. You know, that is karma. You are just not satisfied. You're not satisfied with your own, just being in your own skin and not, looking for praises and all the time. And it can happen with the food. It can happen with, anything. It can happen mentally, physically. And we get into this desire, which is a rolling ball, constantly becoming bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. So that's karma. And how to get rid of it? Through Brahmani, we chant the mantra. I'm Reem Shreem, Am Aam Soh, Brahmani Matre, Kama Sanjeevinye Nama, Pahi Maam Rakshamam. If you chant that, you can overcome your karma, this greed, this thing of constantly, this pleasurable thing that you constantly want. Remember your first love? How it was just like sucked into it. I remember my first experience. It was like you could not get enough of it, And that's what happened. Karma is actually also sexual. It's sexual desire. So it's a loop. She'll show you that. She'll get you, she'll suck you in, and you will be like rolling in it until you cry, until you are ready to like give up. Like, I don't want to be in this anymore. Please take me out, mother. Like, I want to have a sense. I want to not forget other things. I just don't want to be in this sexual energy of karma, constantly wanting more and more and more. and then she will bring you out of it. So this is actually, sometimes these matrikas are ugra because they really take you into that experience. They suck you in and show you the worst of it, so you can ask for to take me out of it. This is the beauty of it, and then you realize you'll never do that mistake ever again. You know, you've had it to the extreme, and now you're ready to move on to the next plane. So this is a very fast way of reaching to divine, the highest plane, you know, because you've experienced it, you're done with it, now you're ready for the next level. So this is what karma represents. Karma is basically sexual desire. Maheshwari. So Maheshwari is the second matrika. So Maheshwari, let me chant the mantra. Trishul Chandra Hare De Hare Maha Vrishbhavahini Maheshwari Swarupena Narayani Namostute. So she is the Shakti of Shiva. So she has the same weapons and, you know, bull and, trident, Trishula, the moon in her hair, Damru in her hand. So all the symbolism of Shiva is in her. So she's his Shakti, right? So she has white complexion with three eyes. Her third eye is open. And she has four arms holding different four ayudhas, four trident, damru, aksharmala, and axe, and kripal. You know, sometimes they're a little bit shown differently. So meditating on her takes away our, what do you think it could be? Anger. So krodha, because Shiva was also known for anger, right? He was if his meditation was disturbed, he got angry very easily. So anger is usually perceived as a, you know, when you are in, something threatens you, your, think of something, your belief system. Like somebody tells you, you know, I don't like what you're saying, I don't agree with you. And suddenly you are, you know, you're all that peace and, you know, your embodiment of love is gone down the drain. Now you want to kill that person, right? That is the anger. That is what it shows, you know, because you're just threatened. Your belief system has been now suddenly put at, so that is what, you know, anger. But in anger, actually, there is also what I found, you know, when I landed in India and my mother was rushed to ICU, and I am living in Canada where I think, you know, somehow everything is very systematic. We are very used to systems. And here, nothing was happening as I wanted. And the anger was showing up for me. And I'm like, if this was in me, I can scream at people. I can do this. Because I had to get my mother into a right place with the right doctor. And every doctor was just saying different things. And I didn't know what was happening. And I had to use... So the anger is also has clarity, actually. Anger has vision in it. So when you're frustrated, is also anger. So it has a positive and a negative side to it. But so she's showing me, you know, like you think you're this peaceful person all the time. Now look at you. You know, I went to go take a taxi to hospital. I had to struggle. And I'm 30 years, I haven't lived in India. So for me, it was like, okay, I have to find my way. I have to do this. Every day I had to take a taxi, go to the hospital, stay overnight, and figure out my strength, my power in anger. I had to find my power in my anger. And that is what anger can be positive as well as negative. But you have to know, she will show you. This is the beauty of the matrikas. She will show you everything that needs to be shown to you. At times you have to be peaceful, at times you have to show your strength, your power, your anger. You have to use it for positivity. And, this is what the mantra for Maheshwari is. Am aam soha Maheshwari matre krodhanashinye nama pahi maam rakshmam. So you're asking her to protect you. Pahi maam rakshmam is to protect you from this anger that can destroy you, or this anger that can build you. You know, what is this anger used for? She's showing you the way. And that's the beauty of these Saptamatrikas. They're always holding your hand. They will take you where you need to go. They will show you, they will guide you, and they'll pull you out of it. So that's krodha. Now the next one is Kaumari.
So Kaumari, Mayur Kukutuk Vrate, Mahashakti Dharen Dhare, Kaumari Rupa Samastite Narayani Namostate. So salutation to the mother who sits on a peacock, bears the great spear, who is the sinless one, and assumes the form of Kaumari. Salutations to that Narayani. So this is a Narayani Stuti that was in the 11th chapter of Devi Mahatmyam. And each one of the mantras I've taken from Devi Mahatmyam. And this is a representation of Kaumari. She sits on a peacock. And sometimes she's shown as six-faced, holding in her hand the danda, dhanu, and bana, and aksharmala, kamandalu. So bana is that spear that she's holding in her hand. That is the spear of Kartikeya. That actually represents spearing through your Sushumna Nadi, all the way from the Muladhara to Sahasrara. Actually, the worship of Kaumari can take you from the earth plane to your third eye, highest plane, which is through all through your chakra. It can spear through your body and bring you straight to the third eye. So that's what that represents, Kaumara's bhala. So, she's worshipped also for the protection of children. So if you have issues with your children, you know, they're not listening to you or they're going through, I felt this was my experience. You know, my son was going through, like, he just wants to get into the music and he wants his career to be music. And I was having an issue with it. He was happy. He's not earning, it's fine. I'm happy. You know, he wants to do whatever he wants to do. But I was like, okay, you're 25. And you need to now, you know, get on with your life. Don't depend on me. So I was asking for help for him. What happened to me was the opposite. The opposite was that I accepted him. I'm like, this is his strength. Maybe he will not succeed today. Maybe he'll succeed after 10 years. But, you know, she opened my eyes to how to accept my children. You know, for whoever they are, whatever they are. This is, you know, I was fighting with myself. Like, I want him successful. I want him, a software engineer who's earning in 10 figures. This was my ambition, not his. So she showed me that where I was at fault. So this is what I found. The Kaumari looks after you and your children and your siblings as well. So worshipping the mantra for Kaumari brings that. And also it power to overcome all the negativity, especially like I said, like it was a negative me of ambition for my children is not my, it's not his ambition, it's my ambition. And I was pushing my ambition onto him. So this was my, you know, negativity that was cleared out. So this attachment of lobha, so that is what it is, lobha, greed. So it showed up for me as greed for my children, but it could show up greed as a negative trait, you know, for an ego. Like, especially for the spiritual people, like I said, like they are always constantly wanting to learn more, get more information, all the knowledge all the time and just not ready to do the work of just doing, not expecting anything, just doing the work and leaving the results out. You know, not looking out to the end. That is hanging on to, you know, all kind of issues. Give me some examples. What could it be for you for lobha, greed? Anybody can give me example of greed? Yeah.
Wanting to shop
endlessly. That's a therapeutic, right? It's like you really want to. It's shopping is therapeutic. So you just never. It never ends because it feels good. Feels good to shop and spend money, and that's the greed. What was your, sorry? Chocolate. Yeah, exactly. We have to know what is our, and I want you to, there's a paper and a pen. Think about your karma, krodha, and lobha. Write down what it is in your, because when we go into the meditation, I'm going to have you look at these in your life. What is your karma? What is your krodha? And what is your lobha? And then we can go into dissolve that in the meditation. So if it's something comes up, take a few minutes. Kama, krodha, and lobha, let's work on those three and write those three for yourself. So in Devi Mahatmyam, the Rakt Bija, whose blood, every drop it falls on the ground, multiple Rakt Bijas are born. What is it? That is the greed, right? It's a mind or that's constant. We have one desire fulfilled and then we want another desire fulfilled, another desire fulfilled. It's never ending. We want a car now, then a house and a bigger house and a bigger house and a double car and, you know, travel the world and one country to 10 countries and it never ends. Now we've reached the, you know, universe now, going into the planets. So it's, where is our greed going to stop? What is it that we are actually wanting from this? What is lacking in us that we are trying to complete? Right? So next one is Vaishnavi. So that Shankh Chakra Gadashangi Grihita Paramayudhe Prasida Vaishnavi Rupe Narayani Namastute. So Vaishnavi is the Shakti of Vishnu. Vishnu. Right? He's like she has the same conch and a disc and a maze and a bow as the Vishnu. Vishnu holds all of that. And so Vaishnavi provides the mystery, the beauty, the order, the Vishnu's, like the dream state. You know, so all that we are in dreaming of, that dream state is Vishnu's Shakti. So, but her Shakti clears out these dream states so you can rise higher. So when you worship her, what you're getting rid of? Delusion. The dream state really doesn't exist, right? It is a delusion. You just don't know what the truth is. So you are just making up stories in your head. And that just keeps multiplying. And so the real truth is right here, right now. But we are actually just in the past or the future, you know, I don't have this, so I want that. And that's your dreams are completely, constantly about lack. So that attachment and the delusion, the power of delusion is what Shahis Shakti removes, the delusion. So that's Mahisasura. If Devi Mahatmyam you have read, Mahisasura, he just keeps changing forms. He just kept changing forms. If every time she came, he was a bull. And then she came, he became a lion. And then she came to kill him, he became elephant. And then he came to... So it's a shape-shifter. It's that delusion, that shape-shifter. It just keeps changing shapes for you, you know? You think, okay, I've overcome this. Like, you know, but then something else shows up. And something else shows up. And it's constantly, it's showing up in you, in your life. You know, that unhappy state, unresolved issues in your life, they just keep showing up. They just keep showing up and you never get over them. Something or the other keeps coming up. So these matrikas actually bring an end to all of that. When you start worshiping them, they show you so that you can overcome it. And you really have to face it. To tell you the truth, like, you know, my sister lives here in Mumbai, and I came with a totally different perspective of life, and she has a different perspective of life. And I were like, you know, it was my delusion that this world should be calm, peaceful place, and everything should run smoothly. The world is a loving universe. All of that, I'm thinking it's like wonderful. And then I come here, and she's like a lioness. She's out there fighting with everyone and screaming at everyone. At first, I was like, why? Why she has to be so rude and mean to so many people? And I was like, it was something in me that wasn't dissolved. You know, it was I who had this delusion that anger is bad or screaming at someone is not right, you know, for getting your work done. It was my thing in my head that I was a peaceful one. You know, all my life people told me, oh, you are the calm and peaceful one. So I did not get that when she was like that. And so It showed my delusions, my own, you know, egotistic ways, what I believe is right, what I believe how the world should be. It's not. Everything is right. Everything is right, and everything that's wrong is also right. So you are just have these projections of yourself into the world. Whatever you're projecting, whatever you know, you're projecting it onto the others. Like, world is a peaceful place and everything should run smoothly, but not really. Like, there are times when things are not running smoothly and you've got to become a lioness and you've got to have the strength to go through it. This was my projection that I had to break through by delusion. So that's what delusion is, you know, your make-believe. Your make-believe or whatever you want to believe in. So especially for the religious people, like, you know, dharma. So much of it believe dharma should be this, or karma should be this. And all, we have so much in our lives. Right? And breaking of all of that is the Shakti of Vishnu. She breaks away everything that you ever believe in. So for me, it was a hard one, really, really hard one, because initially I was fighting with her. I was like, why are you so rude to your maids? And why can't you be nice to them? Like, she's day in and day out, she's doing this, and she has to get her work done. So I was like, and then I had to be rude. That was a rude awakening for me. Like, I had to be rude because I had to get on time somewhere and my things weren't done. And I figured that, you know, my delusion of that thing was totally, it was wrong. My belief system was wrong. You know, so that's what, look into yourself and see what is your delusion. Write a word or two about your delusion.
You said one day you had to be rude.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so much of that is needed to able to survive. The question of reflection for me is to, if everything is taken as acceptance, then when life begin to perfect, there is aspiration is needed for something better to emerge.
Yes.
So in this space, where is the space of that aspiration? If I'm ready to be at ease with everything,
yeah,
where is the space of aspiration in that moment, is my question.
Yeah. So these are they're in our subconscious mind. You know, these aspirations we have are actually at a very superficial level, but there's certain deep, deep stuff that's stuck inside us. Like, I thought I was embodiment of peace and love. All I embodied was the love and peace and joy and happiness. I could not see myself as that, but my aspiration, that's what my aspiration was, to show that, you know, to be the love of the divine, to have happy joy. And then this aspect of me also exists in me. I was denying that. The fact that I can do this, I was denying that with it. It was in my subconscious. So that was brought forward for me. As I did the Sapta Matrika, they were bringing up that I didn't think I was. I was ever told that I could have that in me. Right? So tell me again. Yes, is there anything?
This is very deeply humbling to hear you at this, what you have to say.
Yeah.
And yeah, no, I've lost my word now.
No, we all actually are, you know, so much talking about peace, love and joy. And being, you know, me, myself, Buddhist, compassion is my dharma. You know, I held on to it like my power, my strength, my peace, my love. I could never see myself as Durga. I just couldn't. And then when the Durga appeared, it was frightening at first, you know. I'm like, but then it is there in me, you know. That is what it is. It is there in me. We have to recognize every aspect that we see in others is also existing in us. And we are denying that part of us.
So in integral yoga, they use the word aspiration in a particular way,
okay,
which is our deep desire for perfection, for the divinity, etc. Yeah. So I'm just connecting your talk with the integral yoga, which is once we begin the path to perfecting ourselves, to making ourselves more conscious, it's as if we activate the unconscious, right? So you cannot become conscious until the light is shone on all your shadow selves.
They're beautiful.
That is where the Sapta Matrikas come in.
Absolutely.
They come in to bring out all those denied blind spots in yourself that you don't see in yourself, you see in everyone else.
Yeah.
Or you project that on everyone else.
Do.
So I think what the Sapta Matrikas are for, their function, their cosmic function, is to bring it out from you if it is in you.
Exactly.
But they're also so the path to there, the transmutation or the bringing into the light and the turning around from the fallen aspect of that emotion into its role in the evolution.
Yeah. Yes. And we need all of it, you know.
Yeah.
Like a mother needs to sometime scold a child, right? And to punish a child to get him on the right track. And so we can't deny one aspect of us. All of it exists in us. And that's what Saptamatrikas do. They break the boundaries. They push you into knowing that all of you exist in everything.
Right? I never made the connection to the seven deadly sins.
Mm.
And that's what this is.
Yeah.
Kama, krodha, lobha, moha.
Absolutely.
So the seven deadly sins, that there is there is a goddess, the Shakti that creates them, but it's also the same Shakti who knows how to transmute them and show you the way out from them. So it's the concept of the poison and the medicine, right?
That's what they are.
Yes.
That's what they are.
Yes.
And they are poison and the medicine.
And the medicine.
So that's why they are in the Bhupura, at the level of Bhupura. We are dealing these every day, actually.
Yes.
But we are not seeing it. We get caught in it and we are like, we're so involved in our life stories.
Yeah.
Right? We are constantly about our life stories and my traumas and my life and my family and my, this happened to me. We're just rolling in that and constantly, we're not evolving through it. So what Saptamatrika does is it evolves you, transmits you.
Mm.
It takes you to a next level, a next level of Sri Chakra, a next level, so you can rise higher.
So in the Bhopura, you mean the square.
The square.
And so they're like the doorkeepers.
They are.
When you're trying to evolve, you have to go through the gateway of these seven emotions.
Absolutely.
So until you've truly mastered those seven emotions and they will give you the grace of that, you can't move further into knowing Shiva Shakti.
Absolutely. You can, but it's still superficial.
Yes.
You know, it's very superficial because you haven't dived deeper into your shadow. Mm. It's actually shadow work.
Yes.
A lot of it is shadow work.
Yes.
And until you've looked into your shadow, really, it's very superficial.
Yeah.
So.
Amazing. I never made the connection. So thank you.
You're welcome. So, Varahi. Next is Varahi. So, Grihito Gramha Chakre Drashto Dhritva Sundare Varaha Rupeni Shive Narayani Namastute. So she is another form of Shiva. And she sits in an Agnya Chakra, actually, in Sri Srividya. And she is a fierce form, right? She has the boar face, two tusks. And she is actually, the Vara is with the is an incarnation of Vishnu. Yes. And he digs the earth because the earth is drowning in the water. And so he digs the earth out and saves the earth. So that's the image of Vara you always see with the digging through the tusk and pulling the earth out and saving the mankind. So that's his Shakti is Varahi. So, you know, she's the ferocious form. And buffalo is the, you know, she's riding on a buffalo. And with six hands and blue body, and has all these ayudhas of, you know, Vishnu, as well as, you know, danda. She's called Dandewali. She has a stick in her hand. So what does that mean? She just straightens you out with a stick. If you need, most I know Varahi as, these are all my experiential. I'm talking a lot about my own, how I've learned these through my own experience. So Varahi is actually, if you have a very chattery brain, like you can't stop thinking, you know, intellectualizing or worrying or whatever it is. Your thought cannot stop. She sits in Agnya Chakra. She stops your thoughts. She basically stops everything that's happening and takes you to the straight Shiva, like silence and stillness. So she's a Matrika that represents the stillness of your mind, basically. So I had to, I was in an Ayurvedic retreat center and I'm trying to do a cleanse. And all I'm thinking about is my life story. Like since, you know, how I was the one, I was never given anything, and you know why I, and I was just drooling over my whole life story. It was a cleanse, 21 days of detox. Detox means it brings up everything in you, you know, mind and your body, everything that's just settled in, it was evoked. So I was going through my whole life story, which was just sad. I, you know, and I was like,
why my mother didn't feed me enough. You know, I was the deprived one, deprived. And my mind would not stop. I was just not. Because she was in hospital, you know, and my sister was taking care of her. And my mother would say, just bring Manisha. You know, you can't do anything. Because I come from Canada, and I really don't know how the things work. And I couldn't talk to doctors, and I couldn't take the taxi and come hospital. This whole experience was like, you know, so she did not trust me with my skills, like I could do something for her. And even though I tried my best, I couldn't please her. You know, I wasn't enough. I wasn't doing enough to get things done for her. In any case, so when I'm in the detox program in Ayurvedic Center, I'm going through all of this. All my life, they have treated me like this, that I can't do anything. And my mind would just go on and on and on and on and on. And I prayed to Varahi. I said, Varahi, Mata, please help me. I just shut my brain. I don't want these negative thoughts. And every day morning, I would go to the Varahi temple, and I prayed to her to shut my brain down. And it worked. I mean, by the end of fourth or fifth or seventh day, I was able to get that quiet peace of mind and just focus on myself and not on everybody else and blame everybody else for my problems. Basically, that's what you're doing. You're blaming everybody else for your problem. So this is that. What is the next? Arrogance. So this is the emotion. You are just like so good, so big, so, you know, you are whatever. This is the emotion that you're glorifying yourself, your pain, your sorrows, whatever it is, you're glorifying it, so making it so big for you that you can't navigate your life through it. No, so that's the arrogance. So Varahi brings you dandevali, humbleness. Totally, she'll bring you down to earth. She will just shut your brain and tell you that, you know, just be quiet, sit down here. This is how her shaktis work. Yeah, so I actually, the Varahi mantra, I'm Gloam, Varahi Ye Nama. If you just chant that, I'm Gloam, Varahi Ye Nama. This will do the work. Or you can do, Am Soh, Varahi Matre Nama, Madanashinye, Pahi Mam Rakshabam. So you can ask her to help you through that. So again, this arrogance always comes because of the lack. No, I'm not good enough. I don't know much, you know, nobody accepts me, nobody takes me for seriously, nobody, all that. Is this, and then suddenly you want to prove that to the world. I am good enough, you know, I am the best. It comes from the lack. It is always from the lack that you want to project this arrogance to the world. If you see people, most arrogant people, they have some lacking, something very deep lacking inside them. You know, so look into yourself. Where is it that your arrogance is showing up? Is it your knowledge, your ego? Where is it that's showing up, you know? Your money, sometimes it's, we go through this in our life. So arrogance and egotism is all related to Varahi. She breaks you and brings you down to earth and saves you from your arrogance, your own arrogance, right? And then comes the Mahendri. Mahendi, Indra's Shakti. So you can see the elephant. Kiritini Mahavrajre, Sahasranayane Nyojale, Vritra Pran Hare Chandri, Narayani Namastute. I wrote these when I was in, you know, I was doing every day, chapter 11, because it was Navratri going on, and I was ending it with chapter 11 prayers, and suddenly they were starting to dawn on me, oh, this is Matrikas. Oh, this is what they're doing. And it was just like every day in Navratri, they were opening up this knowledge that I felt like I had to find more about it and figure out how it's working through me. So she's sitting on an elephant, red complexion, holding a vajra and kalasha. So the Shakti of Indra, right? One who's, so Indra loves to celebrate. He's, you know, he also doesn't want anybody else to take his place. So what do you think is his emotion? Matsarya. He's a jealous one, right? He doesn't want anybody else to come and take his place. So his Shakti is that takes away the jealousy, like everybody else is better than me. You know, he has a car and I don't. He has a Lamborghini and I have only Maruti. You know, I want the biggest house that he has.
all of that inadequacy in us. That's what, it's a lack of what's missing in our life. We are constantly comparing ourselves to others, constantly going through this, like, you know, that jealousy is like, it's never ending. Again, all of these are that we have to dive deep into ourselves. And basically, it's a blockage in our, if in an Ayurvedic perspective, it's a blockages in our nadis, it's a blockages in our chakras, it is blockages in our pranavayus, is the apanavayu is stuck. And that's why we are not able to process. Actually, the detox I did was eye-opener for me in Ayurvedic detox for 21 days. Because as all of these just dissolved. As I'm doing the purification in the body, my mind is letting go of all of this. And I was just like, and it was also Navratri, just coincidence, but it was, everything was just working out to process, cleansing process was going on deeply for me, as you can see. So, you know, jealousy. I was jealous of, you know, I, in Canada, I am the maid servant, I am the cook, I am the cleaner, I am the driver, I am babysitter, I'm doing everything. And here you just like, you know, you just order around and you think you own them. It was all of this I had in my head, all of this paradigm I got in my head, like, I mean, you know, you have such a good life here and still you're screaming at them, how dare you? You know, I wanted to come and touch their feet. And I'm like, you know, they are just beautiful people who are taking care of you. And then, you know, it just, my jealousy to my sister and her life and so well she's doing, and all of that was just showing up for me. It was showing up deeply in me, you know, how I was this. And then I started to pray and I saw that this was perfect for her. And what I had to go through was perfect for me. And I didn't have to be jealous compared to her and myself with her at any time. Like, you know, I mean, I need to, in her shoes, I would have done the same thing. And that opens up your mind, you know, you open up that, you know, you are projecting your values onto her. Me and my sister had like huge, humongous fights during my mother in ICU. And I'm going through all of this and I'm just seeing like, look at you, Mukta, all of this, you're teaching meditation. You're teaching and then you have jealousy in you. Look at you telling her how to live your life. Where is your own, Nikki? You know, you have so many gifts. Where are you looking at your own gifts? You've had so much in your life, the gifts. Look at them. So the jealousy had to be taken out of my own mind. And I had to work through that. So look at your jealousy. What is it that makes you jealous, looking at someone else? And also we see it in offices. Like if you're a working woman, like, you know, jealousy is like, I'm going to climb up higher. That means I have to pull 10 people down. You know, but your jealousy shows up in your work environment the most. Like if I have to climb up, I need to really prove myself better than everybody else. And that makes me, you know, somehow I have to walk on other people and get there. So think of how you're using these. And then when we use the mantra, Am Am Soha Mahendri Matre Nama Matsarya Nashinye Pahi Mam Rakshamam. So you're asking her to take away the matsarya, jealousy in you. And when you do the Devi Mahatma in my 11th chapter, you're chanting them, you're asking them constantly. That's why it's such a Devi Mahatma is such a transformative. We don't even realize the power of the whole text, you know. I mean, sometimes I'm just chanting and I have no idea what's being said also. But then when you're in the process of cleansing, they start to become clearer to you. So the last one, Chamunda. Dramst Jot Karalavadale. Shiromala Vibhushane Chamunde Munda Matne Narayani Namostate. Chamunda of the red complexion, deep set eyes, fierce look, hair blistering upwards, embraced. You know, look at her whole body, the skull of mala of skulls in her head. This is a form of Kali, or Chamunda. Right? She's holding a skull and a head and a gada, so a representation of. So, what could be the shakti, what the emotion? Chandamunda. If you hear the story, the first, the Devi when she comes in the Devi Mahatmyam, she comes in to the Chandamunda is the first people who see her and that get very enamored by her and go to Shumba and Nishumba, who's the king, and tell, you must capture this woman, otherwise your glory is nothing. If you don't have her, you are nothing. And so Chandamunda is the, what she cuts the head of Chanda and Munda and brings it to the Durga and says, here you are. So that's why she's called Chamunda. But what does Chandamunda represent? Chanda is a chattering brain. And Munda is your body that is constantly wanting, like, you know, I need more, I need more, I need more, I need everything, I need everything. So Chandamunda is this desire, uncontrollable desire of the mind, and the Munda is of the body. So that is Chandamunda, and they are the ones who are... So Kali, when she has to... She's a representation of Kali, and Rakta Bija and Chandamunda, she kills them all, because the Kali, when every blood that drops on the ground, multiple asuras are born, right? And Devi does is ask Kali to open her tongue and spread her tongue so wide that no blood can actually touch the ground, and she drinks the blood of each and every one of them so that no other asuras can be born. So that's your chattering brain. Yeah, that's a brain that each one thought leads to another, to the another, to the another. A thought is our constantly blah, 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 blah. We cannot really shut our brains down. That is our chanda brain, you know, constantly going and chattering brain. Our children are like, thoughts are our children. Like, we are just constantly feeding them. And everything that we feed multiplies tenfold. And so Kali comes and takes the blood, so it cannot multiply anymore. She takes the blood and she drinks it. So that's what it cannot multiply. That is why Kali is worshipped so much. She takes away every negativity that you have. So the whole Devi Mahatmyam is about passion and dispassion. Actually, Chandamunda is passion and dispassion. That's what they represent. Too much passion and then dispassion. So nothing is at this point, you know, of Devi Mahatmyam, it's realization that nothing is good and nothing is bad. Basically, you are... dispassion is like, I'm no good, I can't do anything. That, like, I'm like Vairagya. You're just going into your own self. That's not what Devi wants you to do. So passion is like, oh, I want that, I want to get it, I want to be, I want to become, I want to do, I want to do. That's passion. Like, your passion is out of control. And dispassion is you're shivering away. You're just going down into your cave. Oh, no. I am just going to just shy away and hide in a plane. That's dispassion. So Chandamunda is passion and dispassion that Devi cuts the head off and brings you to, you know, your own strength, your own power to just be strong, stand in your will, stand in your power. So that's the passion. And you have given up, as you do the sadhana, you begin to realize all of these up till now were these seven matrikas who are just clearing the negativity out of you. And then comes the Maha Lakshmi, who... passion and dispassion. Yeah. Mada, Matsarya, and Chamunda is Chandamunda, which is the passion and dispassion. Basically, because Shumba Nishumba, Raga Dvesha, you can Shumba Nishumba, like everything is auspicious, and Nishumba, which is like, you know, nothing is auspicious, nothing, everything is bad. People who are like constantly complaining, my life is miserable, everybody is miserable, you know how I go through the trauma and everything is wrong in my life, everything is, that's like dispassion. You are just not engaging in your life. And passion is just too much. Like, you're just going after one thing overall. You're not seeing the global, you're not seeing the benefit of all. You're just going by your own. I need to get rich. I need to become big. My ego should be, ego is one of them. My ego should be big, inflated, right? Ahankara. So that is what she kills. She kills the, your ego, your passion, dispassion, both, Chanda and Munda. She just brings it down so that you can realize there's no good, there's no bad. There's no right, there's no wrong. There is absolutely nothing. She will show you the bad to show you the other side. Now, this is the life. You have to navigate through everything. You have to navigate yourself through everything and accept it and move through it, you know? So, and a lot of it is, then comes the grace, right? You have gone, then the grace is Mahalakshmi. She gives you the grace. And Lakshmi Lajje Mahavidde Shraddhe Pushtite Samvide Dhruve Maharatri Mahamaye Narayani Namaste. She's the Asht one, Ashtamatrika. So she is overarching principle. When you have worked through all your negativity, she will come and give you everything. She is the prosperity that comes in after you have worked through your shadows. You know, people think like, oh, I worship Mahalakshmi and I'm going to get everything. It does not work like that. Definitely not, you know, just keeping the yantra, Sri Yantra in your house and getting the luck. Does not work like that. It is a Khadagamala. It is the whole cutting of your sword, you know, sword and getting your, hanging your head off to the Devi. Basically giving it off to Devi and you work through me now. Letting just surrender that you work through me and I accept everything. And then the grace starts to flow. So also in Ayurveda, I have to tell you that these matrikas represent in our body. You know, Ayurveda, we have rasa, rakta, mamsa, medha, asti, majja, shukra. That is how our bodies, our constitution, our bodies are made up of these thing. Rasa is the plasma, the fluid, that white fluid. If you ever do blood test, you will see the red fluid and then they will see a white fluid. That white fluid is rasa, actually. That's the plasma. That represents by Brahmani. Remember the chocolate? You know, yum yum chocolate? That is the rasa. So, you know, think about what in your life, just put that chocolate can be replaced by your fights with your family. It's equally tasty and equally yummy, you know, when you're fighting with your husband. And you say, how much fun is that? It's equally tasty like chocolate. Think about it. You know, there's enjoyment in it. So that rasa, the enjoyment of that fight is, you know, rasa brahmani. Rakta is the blood that flows in our body, that transmutes, transportation, oxygen, nourishment through the body is Maheshwari. So she is the, you know, provider of all of our needs, you know, creation. And Maheshwari is also destruction. She's also destruction, but oxygen, life-giving as well as the destruction. So mamsa is the muscle tissue. Kaumari is related to muscle tissue. A lot of time, the sadhana of Varahi, actually, we go through these. You know, this is the way the Sri Yantra, Sri Chakra Pujas and Sri Yantra and all of that is a fantastic way to connect to your inner being, your inner bodies, and we go through and activate these in our body, our rasa, rakta, mamsa, maeda, masti, majja, shukra, through these matrikas also. So Varahi is asti, you see asti dhatu. So if you have bone joint issues and you pray a mantra to Varahi, you actually can get relief from your bone and joint issues. So there are mantras that just to remove your arthritis, you know, and they work. They really do. I mean, and Majja is your brain, your Mahendri, which controls your brain power. And Chamunda is your Shukra. So Shukra is the fluid that is responsible for reproduction, you know, sperm, the egg. And we get that, and that's Chamunda. Finally, your progeny. How does your progeny become good, you know, and have none of the issues? So by removing all the negativity through your blood system, through your head, everything, you just work through all of them. In Sri Vidya, you will learn all of that. So, you know, you work through the mantras are very powerful. Also, matrikas represent Vac Devtas, you know, which are... It is believed that the 52 alphabets of the Sanskrit language emanate from the mother, and she takes the name of every one of them. So like I was talked about eight, you know, that from the triangle, the eight triangles came into being, and the letters were the Vak. Shakti was made there, and they are also representation of matrikas. So let me show you this. These are the letters, and the Brahmani is associated with ka varga. Ka, kha, ga, gha, na. That's Brahmani. And Maheshwari is cha, cha, ja, ja, nya. Kaumari is ta, tha, da, da, na. Vaishnavi is ta, tha, da, da, na. Varahi is pa, pa, ba, ma, ma. Indrani is ya, ra, la, va. And Chamunda is sha, sha, varga, sha, sa, ha, la, sha. So all of this is also, they had many planes, right? They're not just as our bhashas, ashtabhashas, our negative eight negative emotions. They're also, if we purify them, we suddenly have the Vak Shakti and we have these come into us. So they are at many, many levels. So these are sitting at the eight triangles. Vashni, Kameshwari, Modini, Vimale, Arune, Jaini, Sarveshwari, Colony. Those are the ones that are eight triangles after the experience.
Are you saying that once the lower forms of the negative emotions get purified, they now express as eight forms of Saraswati?
Yeah, and also your Vak Shakti comes in to speak, to talk, because you've clarified. You know, you've let go of so much and now you have the gift of speaking.
Speech.
Your experience, expressing it, talking, and those are the Vak Devtas.
Incredible.
Mm-hmm. The whole sadhana of Sri Chakra is very deep and it takes you to very many levels. So it's not just chanting of the mantras, Khadagamala, it is going very deep. So I'll take questions now and then we can probably do a meditation.
I was wondering, like, you know, my guru was also saying that, you know, meditating on chakras can lead you. So I think meditating on the Sri Chakra first is the outer level. First takes out your negativities.
Absolutely.
First getting you indulge in that and then they show it up.
Mm-hmm.
That there's no end to it. Like you want and keep wanting it.
Yeah, exactly.
So then ultimately you go out of it. And like, since your gurus are having such a very, very interesting topic, if they could also show some light on the whole thing, because there's
absolutely
a lot of personal interpretation in what you all said. So
yes,
possible,
there's so much depth to it, please. Yes, I think they have 2 days, next 2 days, and I really hope they will talk more. There's so much in this, I can't even express that, I don't have the words yet.
Thank you, I really enjoyed that, and I must say, I love the dark side. And if it's missing, I get a little nervous because if it's missing the dark side of humanity, I get a bit nervous because I don't think it's the truth. And there's nothing more beautiful to me than the truth, the whole truth, which involves the dark side. And that's as beautiful.
Absolutely.
In lots of ways. And I just a couple of comments before I ask my question. You were talking about delusion, and I know a lot about that, having had many and still have many delusions. But the beautiful thing about coming from a Western culture where I know nothing about what you're talking about is it does have this sort of opening quality. And I've really appreciated that over the last days, is that I'm open because I know nothing. The language even is new. So that was a real gift I didn't expect.
Beautiful.
And the mantras, the fact that you don't need to do years of talk therapy, that you can do mantras, which
absolutely,
of course, translates to me to prayer. So that is a beautiful thing. I will be looking into those.
Yeah.
And I think that's a wonderful way to rid yourself of those, is it pashmas?
Pashas.
The question is, you're talking about shadow work, and I've had a couple of dark nights of the soul, and it's frightening as much as it is beautiful and enlightening. But you said that when the shadow work is done, I guess then you sort of meet the divine. You didn't say that, but that's my interpretation.
Sure.
And yet, I am still finding parts of my shadow. It's just I know how to work through them quickly and they don't take down my system. So I can move through them with more lightness mm-hmm. and be triggered and say, aha, another one, come show yourself to me. Is it the case that you have to be rid of all your shadows, are they in your genes? Are they in your past life? Do they keep sort of showing themselves to you?
Yeah, exactly. So how I understand. First of all, that you talked about the mantra work that you appreciate so much, and how they work is they are actually sound vibrations. So what they do is they activate that vibration that needs to be cleared. So it is as you're chanting the mantra, they can be just one glom, gum. You know, they're actually one bija words, mantras, that can activate that sound vibration that can break through in your subtle body. These are sitting in your past lives. It could be enormous. It could be coming from anywhere. Your this life, this karmas, whatever is your mind going through. What the mantras do is they break through. These sound vibration, like these matrikas, you know, you can see this ka, kha, ga, ga is Brahmani. And if that's why when we are making the 1,000 names of Devi, and they're starting with ka, ka varga, kameshwari, kamlatmika, whatever we are doing, we are activating the ka. And that ka sound is breaking through, that sound is breaking through certain patterns in your life. So that's how it works.
Which is why it crosses it crosses language barriers.
Exactly.
Right? Beautiful. Thank you.
And so the shadow work, like there is you cannot see the light without the shadow. So shadow work is very important. If we don't know our negative patterns, how are we going to see the positive? So to see the positive, we have to see the negative. But we can keep dwelling in it. And we can be lost in it. We can be lost in light also. So it's a pendulum that needs to swing constantly in your life. I feel like we have taken birth to come to do this work in our lives. That's why they never end. You said it's never ending. It's never ending. It really is. Because we've come to do this work in our life to constantly watch at our pashas and come to the balance, to the center. See our light come to the balance, see our dark come to the balance, being in the center, constantly watching, constantly observing, bringing to balance. And when we keep doing this work constantly, bringing it to balance ourselves, not playing too much dark, not playing too much light, just being in here in mother's lap, as I call it, just staying in mother's lap and let her do the work, this thing, our karmas, our past lives, everything starts to dissolve. You start to feel lighter, you start to feel better, you just don't, that thing that holds you so, that it's you are in its grip, you know, you can't leave that emotion in you. And suddenly you chant a mantra and it's gone. It's done with. You know, it is magic. Even though I don't want you to believe in magic, it is magic. It takes work. So once you start playing with the mantras, 24/7 it goes in your head. You know, the mothers are amazing. They're playing with you. They're playing with you. They're showing you your dark, your light, and constantly making you work on yourself. And what more? I mean, I think it's a beautiful path. For me, that's what I chose. I chose to work with it.
Thank you for that very illuminating talk. I have two questions for you. Mm-hmm. You mentioned Navratri when you were talking about.
Yeah.
So how are the Saptamatrikas different from the Navdurgas?
So I think Navdurgas is covered by, Radha and Anant Lakshmi on 9th day, and they will be talking. Okay. The Saptamatrikas are smaller mothers. They come out of the big mother. She appoints these to do the work. So they come and do, but they are her form, right? They're her form who comes down to help get rid of the other negative qualities in you.
Okay, so the second question is about the Shakti, the tradition that you come from.
Yes.
And it's a personal question that I have. It's about choice and calling.
Yeah, yeah.
You said that your mother was also from the same tradition.
Sure.
So you already had a path that you could see. For somebody who's not from this tradition, say somebody's a Shaivite or a Vaishnavite or whatever, And if he wants, or if he or she feels that this tradition, the worship of the mother is a better way to do it, how do you choose? And then the thing is, then if all your life you've been worshipping Shiva as the supreme being, and suddenly now you do this, won't Shiva get angry?
No. I just wanted to share an answer for this.
So please do.
So, my father was a communist and he believed in no God. And then we are by birth Sri Vaishnavites, that is followers of Mahavishnu. And my great-grandfather built so many temples of Vishnu. And suddenly my father became a Devi Upasaka. The entire family thought that he had lost his brain and that he was doing something very, very different from what we are supposed to do. But my father just felt that that was what he wanted to do. So it doesn't, I think when it comes, it just comes. Like I am also a Sri Vaishnavite, right? Because I'm born to the same family. But I'm a great believer of Mahadev. So for me, Varanasi is important. Har Har Mahadev, Mahadev ki Kripa. You'll find these lines in my mouth all the time. So it doesn't matter. I think finally, it's all about taking different routes to the same place.
Yeah.
So you want to go to Churchgate, you're going to take the train, or you're going to take the BST bus, or you're going to take a car, or you're going to go through Parel, or you're going to go through Shivaji Park. It doesn't matter. Finally, you're reaching Churchgate. That's what is important.
Yeah. And also, I just wanted to say Shiva and Shakti are the same. So you see at the Bindu, they are not separate. They are one. And he has never actually, he's the observation. He is, wherever Shakti is, Shiva is. Everything that you do, if you do with focus, observation, attention, Shiva is the one who is the focus, observation, and attention, consciousness. That is observing the play. They're never separate. They're never, ever separate. So there's no Shiva and Shakti, that's duality. This is the, you know, when you worship them as one. And the union that my guru talks about, you know, intercourse. Constantly intercourse with the universe. You are whatever you're doing, you're making love to it. You're having that experience fully so that the observation and observer and the first triangle, subject, object, and the observation, process of observation is all one. And that's when it takes you to Shiva and Shakti. So you have to remember that it's not separate. You do Shiva, you will be doing Shakti. You do Shakti, you'll be doing Shiva. There is no separation. Yeah.
Where does Kuladeva come in this?
Sorry?
Kuladevam.
Yeah, sure. They are actually matrikas. I forgot to mention that. I was showing you the seal of Indus Valley civilization. And so every village had a deity, a matrika, who they worship. Mother is the form who protects you. Like, you know, mother is seen as someone you can communicate with. Father, you may not be able to go and tell everything to, but your mother you always feel more closer to, right? So every village, every town, everything had this mother figure that everybody could go and worship, and that mother represented that for them, you know, their power, their strength that gives them an energy, and they brought life to it. So that's the Kula. Each village had its own mother that would protect them through diseases, to famine, through, you know, whatever is going on. They would have that faith and they would bring her to life to protect them. So those are Kul Matrikas.
I mean, culturally, there is also fear that is thing. When we start praying the Sri Yantra, I mean, I come from a family where, you know, Sri Yantra is worshipped. Our forefathers were doing, we discovered a Meru. We didn't know what to do with it. So we finally went and gave it to the temple because we knew that something had to be done with it. But we were not given the knowledge system as to how to worship her. Okay. So finally we went and gave it to a temple and where the Sri Chakra Puja is done. But there is, because of which, there's a certain fear. I mean, I don't know whether culturally, whether you know this. In all astrology, when you look into your astrology, it says, okay, there is a Devi Kopam. So why is this fear psychosis built with worship of the mother, that if you don't look at her or you don't worship her, then she's going to slap you and she's going to bring you to your knees. Is that truth?
No. Absolutely not.
So this is what, you know, I mean, the fear was developed to create, you know, the lineage so that you stay, don't break through it. And, you know, 6 hours, 10 hours of puja and all of that was like, it was fear-based. If you don't do, you are going to get punished. You know, everything was fear-based to keep the religion, to keep that norm going. Whereas, you know, my guru, Guruji Amritananda, he always talk about, you know, simplifying things and making it accessible to everyone, making it understandable to everyone, you know. So everybody can do this. In 1 hour, you can, in 5 minutes also, just the right dhyanam, and they are there. So it has not got to, the fear is not a part of it. It's created by the human mankind to, you know, to have their supremacy. But the real sadhana is liberates you. It breaks through all of this. It breaks through the norm.
So, Mukta, I have such deep gratitude bubbling up in me. Okay. I mean, I had no idea what you're going to do today. And it could not have been more perfect with... it's one thing to talk about Shakti and talk about goddesses, and some of the last evening sessions have been a bit too academic. But, well, it's brilliant, absolutely brilliant to those who are interested in that and they understand it. But I keep thinking about our international audience and people who've come from Australia and Germany and who've never, you know, heard these Sanskrit words before. But what you did is you brought it right back to the human experience, right? That, and I just want to build on a couple of minutes to build on what you have shared. That Shakti, basically all is energy, and every energy has a intelligent being behind it. It's not just some mechanical energy that doesn't belong to anybody. There is some sort of a sentient being, and that is the Devi or Devata. So behind every energy is a consciousness, is a being. And which is why if we want to enter into any kind of mastery of that energy, so for example, emotion is energy in motion. And one of the greatest problems of being human is emotions. They hijack us and they topple us from our sense of centeredness and peace. I mean, it's the bane of being human, you know, having emotional upset.
Yeah.
And to know that behind every emotion is energy,
yes.
And behind every energy is a being,
yes.
And you can enter into relationship with that being.
Exactly.
And that being that got in the Indic tradition, she's a Shakti, and you gave us their names. And if you bring it down to the seven great negative emotions that assail the human experience.
Yeah.
Well, here are the seven great goddesses, matrikas,
yeah.
Who you can enter into relationship with and who will then give you the boon.
Yes.
So they're both, as we said, the poison and the remedy.
Yes.
Because until we master, so mother's line in yoga ultimately is to know yourself and to control yourself.
Yes.
So to know that these seven energies will move through us
yeah.
all the time, at any time,
yeah.
And then how do we control them?
Yeah.
And what you shared with us today is such a profound path from the Indic knowledge system.
Yeah.
And I'm just blown away. And we know every goddess and what she looks like and her color and her, you know, her vehicle. And this is the mythic, it's like a mythopoetic
yes.
understanding of anthropomorphization
yes.
of the energy of that emotion,
right? Yeah.
And this is how you enter into relationship with it. So
yeah.
eventually, it won't control you.
Yeah.
It can help you transcend the lower version of it.
Yes.
And then you can receive and express the higher version of that same Shakti.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's why it's, I just wanted to elaborate that. That's why it's, the Tantra has been given a bad name.
Mm.
The Tantra means, you know, the vehicle to transform, to transmute. So you have this relationship with this God and goddesses. And you have, this is a, like we didn't have in olden days psychologists and psychiatrists. What worked was these methods of changing yourself. Your mind, your spirit, your being, was through these practices that we could become a higher being. And we didn't have to talk to anyone. We just had a relationship with the goddess. And that goddess guided us through a journey to transform. You know, we didn't have to pay money to any psychologist, psychiatrist. We just did our own work, our shadow work and our light work, and then we are transformed.
So I like what you said, you know, having this relationship with these goddesses is what
and
makes it special. Yeah.
We have Ziyanath, who's going to take us through the Sufi whirling.
Wonderful.
And the 99 names of the beloved. So I was very reminded of Mevlana Rumi's poem. Mm-hmm. It speaks to what you shared today. It's called The Guest House. This being human is a guest house. Every morning, a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness, some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all, even if they are a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture. Still, treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice, meet them at the door laughing and invite them in. Be grateful for whoever comes because each has been sent as a guide from beyond.
Yeah, thank you so much. That's beautiful. That really is beautiful. I have my email is mukta@healingbymukta. My website is healingbymukta.com. So if you want to reach me anytime, healingbymukta or my email, mukta@healingbymukta.com. You can always contact me, send me your questions, whatever you have.
Sri Matre Namaha. I think somebody mentioned as to how do we, you know, about fear, first and foremost about fear. I just wanted to add one more thing. Guruji, my father used to always say, you know, does a mother get angry if the child does not, you know, say the things properly? That's as simple as that, he would say, you know. And even for things like Lalita Sahasranamam, not just Meru, even Lalita Sahasranamam to chant, he would say the same thing. He used to not have any holds, any, you know, bars or thing. And in fact, when we had the first yagam, the thing, at that time he wanted that he had gone to the person who's going to organize the home, the yagnam and all that thing. And he said for Suvasini Pujas, he wanted only Suvasitis, only married ladies. And Guruji was very clear. He said, why not the unmarried ladies or why not people who are divorced or widowed? He said, no, I cannot accept that. Then that man said, that's a deal breaker for him. He said, I cannot accept that. And he went away. And the mother spoke to that person, the person who's going to be carrying on the yagna, and he showed him the path. And then he came back to my father and he said, your ways, she has shown me where I am wrong. So that's the way, you know. So fear about these things, you know, you can leave them behind. Have the fear, but, you know, just leave it the same. Because you're going to the mother's lap. So nothing to say. Mm-hmm. And the more important thing what I would like to say is, for all these karma growth, all of these things, the point of change comes when you are aware that you are at that point. Till the time you're angry, just saying you don't realize you're angry, you can do nothing. Mm-hmm. The moment you realize that you are angry, you have the choice. Either you can step up and change or see what is it that's going wrong. See what is it that you can correct. Or you can continue to be in the anger, or you can go further down, get even more angry. So that point of change is that awareness of that anger, of that emotion, of that whatever it is that you're feeling at that point of time. And the more and more that you are able to be aware of that particular thing, your things start shifting for you. Because then you are able to make choices, conscious choices, faster. So otherwise, sometimes the choices are happening by default. Your default mode is running. Yeah. You don't want your default mode to be running. You want your conscious choice to be made. Sometimes you are very angry. Okay, it doesn't matter. I want to continue to be angry. It doesn't matter. But it's a conscious choice that you are making. So realize that. So then that would...
Beautiful. Yeah.
That's what I wanted to just share. Sri Mata Namaha.
So grateful.
Another way to say it is you have to feel it to heal it.
Yeah. Right? And not escape.
And not escape from it.
Yeah.